Good morning. Welcome to this service of worship at Oakland United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Carolyn, and I am so glad that you joined us this morning. Today is Ascension Sunday. Ascension Sunday commemorates Jesus' ascension, or return to heaven, 40 days after his resurrection. It's Jesus' last message to his disciples. And in that message, he gives them their marching orders. They are to wait in Jerusalem until the power of the Holy Spirit comes upon them, and then, empowered by the Spirit, they are to be Christ's witnesses throughout the world. They are to testify to the power, grace, and forgiving love of God shown in Christ's life, death, and resurrection, and offer salvation to all in Christ's name. The mission that Jesus gave those first disciples has been passed down to us. We are called to testify to the power, grace, and love of God by the way we love and care for our neighbor, sometimes in big ways, but more often in those daily acts of love, kindness, and compassion that we do in little ways. Let us join in our opening prayer. It is wonderful to be grateful and to sing your praises, Lord Most High. It is wonderful each morning to be able to tell others about your love and at night to announce how faithful you are. You do great things, Lord. We enjoy praising your name because everything you do makes us glad and we sing songs of joy. You have given us strength to be your people and you have chosen us to be your very own. Good people will prosper like palm trees and they will grow strong like the cedars of Lebanon. They will take root in your house, Lord God, and they will do well like trees that stay healthy and fruitful, even when they are old. And they will say about you, the Lord always does right. God is our mighty rock. And our song is, Christ the Lord is risen today. Our first scripture reading this morning is from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Dear Theophilus, in the first volume of this book, I wrote on everything that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he said goodbye to the apostles, the ones he had chosen through the Holy Spirit and was taken up into heaven after his death. He presented himself alive to them in many different settings over a period of 40 days. In face-to-face meetings, he talked to them about things concerning the kingdom of God. As they met and ate meals together, he told them that they were on no account to leave Jerusalem, but must wait for what the Father promised, the promise you heard from me. John baptized in water, you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and soon. When they were together for the last time, they asked, Master, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? Is this the time? But Jesus told them, you don't get to know the time. Timing is the Father's business. What you'll get is the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea and Samaria, even to the ends of the world. These were Jesus' last words. As they watched, he was taken up and disappeared in a cloud, and they stood there staring into the empty sky. Suddenly, two men appeared in white robes, and they said, you Galileans, why do you just stand there looking up at an empty sky? This very Jesus who was taken up from among you to heaven will come again as certainly and mysteriously as he left. And our gospel reading is Luke 24, verses 44 through 53. Then Jesus said, everything I told you while I was with you comes to this. All the things written about me in the law of Moses, in the prophets, and in the Psalms have to be fulfilled. He went on to open their understanding of the word of God, showing them how to read their Bibles this way. He said, you can see how it is written that the Messiah suffers, rises from the dead on the third day, and then a total life change through the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed in his name to all nations, starting from here, from Jerusalem. You're the first to hear and see it. You're the witnesses. What comes next is very important. I am sending what my Father promised to you, so stay here in the city until he arrives, until you're equipped with power from on high. Jesus then led them out of the city over to Bethany, and raising his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he made his exit, being carried up into heaven. And they were on their knees worshiping him. Then they returned to Jerusalem, bursting with joy, and they spent all their time in the temple, praising God. This is God's good news, and for it, we are thankful. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks for this day, for our ability to worship, and for the Spirit that you have given us. We pray that the Spirit will plant the seeds of your word deep in our hearts, that they might bear the fruit of love in our words and actions. Amen. It's commencement time again. Last year, of course, most in-person high school, college, and university commencement services were canceled or went virtual due to COVID. But this year, institutions are once again hoping to hold ceremonies that resemble as much as possible traditional graduation exercises. Many have decided on virtual ceremonies, but others are planning to host in-person commencement with accommodations in place for COVID. But whether virtual or in-person, commencement ceremonies are still pretty much the same wherever you go. The commencement ceremony usually follows a pretty standard format with traditional music, pomp and circumstance, and features a commencement address as its centerpiece. And because it's the centerpiece of the ceremony, the address is often delivered by a celebrity, a well-known artist, a famous alum, a business leader, or a prominent politician, particularly at more prestigious institutions. Now, frankly, I don't particularly remember any of the commencement addresses offered at my high school, college, seminary, or graduate school graduation ceremonies. It's safe to guess, though, that the speakers probably offered their version of lofty, inspiring, earnest, and perhaps humorous advice for us newly minted graduates. And they probably spoke about finding fulfillment, reaching our potential, changing the world. But Professor Timothy Burke of Swarthmore College, in his 2002 commencement address, cautioned the graduates he addressed about their rush to get out and make out into the world and make changes immediately. He told the graduates, "Of course I want you to do good, not just be good, but act with good intent in the world. And of course I want you to change the world for the better. But doing good, it seems to me," he continued, "is frequently not a matter of commitment to causes or fidelity to ideologies. It's usually a matter of small decencies and ordinary kindnesses." He continued, "It's harder in some ways, day in and day out, to be a good parent, a good friend, a good partner, a good teacher, a good colleague, than it is to minister to thousands of lepers or airlift food supplies to a famine-stricken region." Unquote. Instead of trying to change the world all at once, Burke coached the graduates to instead become students of the world, tuning in to the systems and workings of their daily lives and those around them, telling the truth about what they saw in the world around them without flinching or hesitation. This kind of bearing witness, telling the truth and acting in context and commitment, requires clear eyes. Those that can see the world for what it really is and what we might realistically do in our little corner of it. Burke went on to say, "If you look at the people who really have changed the world for better, because most injustice is systematic and really does require systematic attention from organized groups of people fighting for what's right, you'll see that most of them didn't set out in life with the activist version of will to power, determined above all things to change the world for the better. Nelson Mandela just wanted to escape an arranged marriage and live his life the way he wanted to. Gandhi just wanted to be a lawyer. If you want to change the world, just wait," he said. "The opportunity will find you at the right time, and when it does, your commitment to change will be organic, a part of your life, rather than something outside it." Unquote. In our passage from Acts this week, Jesus offers his own version of a commencement speech for his disciples as they graduate to become his apostles. In it, he gives them his own advice for how they can change the world. Today is Ascension Sunday, the day in which we celebrate Jesus' return to his Father following his resurrection. The Ascension marks the end of Jesus' earthly ministry and the beginning of the disciples' work, continuing that ministry in the world, empowered by the Holy Spirit. For Luke, the Ascension is the hinge that connects his gospel and the book of Acts, which he also wrote. The gospel passage gives the impression that Jesus' resurrection and ascension happened on the same day, but in the book of Acts, the two events are separated by 40 days, a number probably more symbolic than literal. But in both accounts, Luke relates that Jesus spends time speaking about the kingdom of God and teaching his disciples, reinforcing what they learned from him during his 3 years that they had followed him during his ministry. And then he commissions them to continue his work as witnesses to all that they had seen and heard during his earthly ministry. And finally, he tells them that they are to remain in Jerusalem until they are baptized by the Holy Spirit, clothed with power from on high, that will enable and embolden them to carry out their mission. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses. This power is to be spent in the act of witnessing for Jesus Christ in a series of expanding circles, first to Jerusalem, and then all of Judea, and then Samaria, and finally to the whole world. Jesus assures his followers that they are not left on their own to do this work. The Spirit they will receive at Pentecost will give them the power they need to be effective witnesses and apostles. The ascension means that Jesus is absent only physically. Through the Spirit, he is still present with them in all times and in all places, then and now. And then after Jesus said these things, as the disciples watched, Jesus was lifted up out of their sight. The language in Acts about Jesus seeing, about the disciples seeing Jesus as he ascends, is not just a minor detail, it's a crucial piece. In the Old Testament book of 2 Kings, just before the prophet Elijah ascends to heaven, he says to his disciple Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha requests a double share of Elijah's prophetic spirit. And Elijah replies, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." Well, Elisha does indeed see Elijah's departure, and therefore receives the double portion of his spirit. So Luke's stress upon the disciples seeing Jesus as he departs from them underlines the promise that they will soon receive the Spirit poured out by Jesus from heaven. It's clear that the Holy Spirit is the link connecting both ministries, that of Jesus and his apostles. But while the disciples are still craning their necks toward the sky like it was a rocket launch, an angel appears to get their gazes back on earth. "Why are you standing there gaping at the sky? Don't look up, look around. Jesus will come back from the sky just as he left. Now stop staring at the sky and get busy. There's work to be done." Now, on the one hand, this story is all about Jesus. It is his miraculous and mysterious departure from this world. Jesus had come to earth from heaven and now returns to reign at the right hand of God. But on the other hand, this story is all about the disciples then and now. It is the event that changes the focus of Christ's work and ministry from Jesus himself to those who follow him. This is Jesus' commencement address to his disciples. Jesus is entrusting the continuation of his work to the disciples then and now, and his encouragement for these graduates and for us today is more about doing the day-to-day jobs before us and less about seeking self-fulfillment and grandiose accomplishments. Jesus tells his disciples then and now to knuckle down and get on with the often gritty and unglamorous job of spreading his message and doing his work. It is now up to them, and by extension us, to continue Jesus' work, to preach the good news of repentance and forgiveness and salvation in Christ's name. It's up to us to heal the sick and feed the hungry, and welcome the outcast and stranger, and to love our neighbors and our enemies. It's up to us to bear witness and tell the truth about what we see in our community, our nation, and our world. It's up to us to use our voice to speak out and speak up for those who are ignored, pushed aside, and silenced by our society. To speak and act against racism in all its forms. to work for economic justice that allows all persons to access what they need, not just to survive, but thrive. It's up to us to keep spreading Jesus' message of grace and mercy, not just in our word and speech, but in our actions and in truth. Sometimes in the face of ridicule and discouragement, and often in the midst of a world that seems indifferent to or even hostile to that message. It's up to us to act in love, no matter what the risk or the cost, even if it's tedious and trying, uncomfortable, or seemingly unremarkable work. The work of being a disciple is not necessarily glorious and exciting. More often, it's found in what Timothy Burke called small decencies and ordinary kindnesses. Small decencies and ordinary kindnesses. Those small acts of faithfulness and kindness that we do in our day-to-day life and in the commitment and courage it takes to continue to follow Jesus day by day, especially when it would be easier not to. There is a prayer commonly attributed to Teresa of Avila, who lived from 1515 to 1582, which poetically expresses this reality. God of love, help us to remember that Christ has no body but yours, no hands but ours, no feet but ours. Ours are the hands, ours are the eyes to see the needs of the world. Ours are the hands with which to bless everyone. Ours are the feet with which he is to go about doing good. Ours is a call to go from the place where we gaze into the clouds to the places where the world needs Christ. We are called by Christ and empowered by the Holy Spirit to be the hands and the feet and the voice of Christ in our community and beyond, sometimes in big ways. But more often, as Mother Teresa said, by doing small things with great love. Amen. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks for this opportunity you have given us to be your hands, your feet, your voice in the world, sometimes in big ways, but more often in the small daily kindnesses and compassion and acts of mercy that we do each day. Help us, Lord, always to keep our eyes open for the ways in which you call us to speak and to act. Help us to look for ways to do your work, to be voices of healing and peace, to be those who work for justice, to be those who speak up and speak out. We pray this morning, Lord, for those who are in need of your healing touch, whether healing is in body, mind, or spirit. We pray that they will find the mercy and grace that they need in your love. We pray, Lord, for all of those who have lost loved ones, that they might find grace and mercy and comfort in the knowledge of your care for them. May you send us to be agents of comfort and strength in the midst of grief. We pray for our leaders, national and international, as they seek to make decisions in the best interests of their people. We pray that you would guide them with your wisdom in the decisions that they are called to make. We pray all of these things, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught his followers to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our song is Sometimes by Step. And let us say, without Christ, all that we have is nothing. With Christ, all that we have is enough. Let us offer ourselves and our gifts to the Lord. I would invite you to send your offerings to support the ministries of this church to Oakland United Methodist Church, 200 North Main, Box 4, Oakland, Iowa, 51560. And let us say a prayer of thanksgiving to those gifts that have come in this past week. Gracious and giving God, you are the one who first has given to us all that we need for life. Guide us to use what we now gather for the well-being of your church, for those in need of shelter and food, for all who suffer for want of your word, and for nurturing faith in your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And our song is Christ is Risen.
Christ is risen, our Shepherd, our King. All creation is of His, in good time.
in the power of the Holy Spirit, go forth into the world to fulfill your calling to live as the people of God, the body of Christ. Go forth in the spirit of wisdom and hope, with eyes opened and minds awakened by the power of Christ. Be assured that wherever you go, Christ is with you. Do your part in bending the moral arc of the universe toward justice and love by doing all the good you can to all the people you can, by all the means you can, as long as ever you can. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly upon you and within you, now and always. Amen.